Welcome to Calvary Christian Church International, and this is Pretoria East, where the wise men reside. Thank you for choosing to fellowship with us this morning. So we are a church you can call home. We are a church that cares for the total needs of the whole man. In our church, we believe you come as you are. Don't change anything, as God will change things on the way. We believe in our vision. And our vision is, we exalt Christ. We evangelize the lost. We enrich the community. We encourage the hurting. And we equip our believers. And our mission is transforming the total man by restoring hope to the hopeless, training leaders to the building of the church where Christ is Lord. We stand firm and grounded on our values, values of constant word, worship, and never-ending prayer. Once again, welcome to Calvary Christian Church, Pretoria East. Sit back and be blessed as we receive the Word of God.
Hello everybody. I hope you are keeping warm and there's very, very cold weather.
Hey, hello guys. Before we get to the gist of the matter, the topic of the week, I just want to say Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. We are because of you guys.
Hey, Happy Father's Day. We really love you and appreciate you guys.
Yo, what's up? It's Frankie here from Calvary Christian Church, Pretoria East.
Social media should and is not a measuring tool of my success or my achievements, because what people portray on social media might not be a true reflection of what is happening in their lives. So why should I compare myself or use that as a way to measure what is happening in my life or how stagnant my life is? So that's why I think that social media should not be used as a tool for measuring someone else's achievement. But then how do I deal with that pressure? I think to deal with that pressure, you need to know yourself, know where you're going, know your worth. Do not be in a competition with anyone. Know that you will get where you're supposed to get at the right time, the appointed time by God. And do not compare yourself with anyone. Don't be in a competition. Life is not a race. Life is all about complementing each other. Because sometimes we realize that, oh, okay, the grass looks greener on the other side. But when we actually get to the other side, we realize life is actually not greener on this side of life. So social media for entertainment. Oh, and by the way, Happy Father's Day to all our fathers, all our daddies out there. May you please enjoy your day.
Interesting, yet so difficult to answer, because we're different individuals and we don't value things the same. I'll simply say, if posting is going to make you happy, then do it. Post. Go for it. But then if it's going to make you sad or unhappy, please don't post anything. Please stop it. Don't do it. And the most important thing, I feel like one must have a good reason why they post their achievements on social media. Yeah. And Happy Father's Day to all fathers. Enjoy your day. And I wish you all the best. And yeah.
The reason that on social media we all post different stuff. Others are real, others are not.
And if ever we keep on measuring our achievements on what we have using what which is posted on social media, we could end up having depression. We could ever end up beating ourselves up for something that we have really worked hard for. So instead of using social media to be your measuring stick, I would say use it to be something that motivates you to do even better and push you better, to even push you to a point where by you're doing your best.
It's just a matter of treading carefully, and like in terms of how you take it, because it can be of positive effect and negative effect as well. Positive in a way that you can actually gauge what other people are currently achieving, you know. So you can actually even try to not limit your mindset or not to limit your dreams, you know, based on what other people are achieving. Then you get to realize that, oh wow, so there are certain things that you can actually get to, you know, in life. And then also negative in a way that I feel like if you allow the pressure to get into you, you're going to start judging yourself or feeling that you're inferior because other people are overachieving. So hence I'm saying that there's positive and negative effects as well. So it's just a matter of just telling yourself that, no man, we are running our own races, you know, on your own lane, you know, I'm sure you know this story. So I think it's very important to just tread carefully with social media. But if you don't know how to deal with it, just rather stay out of social media once, you know.
Say happy Father's Day. We really love you and appreciate you guys.
This poem is for the fathers, men who have not only sown seed, but have nurtured its growth. Those who work hard to put food on the table and yet are present at the same table to share grace. Men who speak the language of love at the level of the cross. Men whose presence provokes peace, not panic. This poem is for the fathers. Men who protect, provide, and prophesy life into their families. Men who boldly stand in the gap on their knees. Men who know that fatherhood is a calling. It has more to do with sharing your heart than planting a seed. This poem is for the present fathers. This poem is for the father figures. This poem is for the male mentors. This poem is for every man doing their bit to raise up the next generation. We see you. We love you. We honor you. We need more of you. This poem is also for my father, who was born on the 16th of June. I ponder the irony of him growing further and further away from his youth every youth day, as the chasm between the national and his personal significance of the day grows wider each year. I then realize the fingerprints of his legacy in me strings the two together, Father's Day and Youth Day. It sometimes seems the days between them are the closest these subjects can get in a generation plagued by fatherlessness, broken bonds, and rebellion. But there still exists an army of present fathers. There still exists an army of hopeful youth. This poem is also for youth. A generation like that in 1976, fighting for justice, fighting for freedom, in a crucible of youth unemployment, depression, addiction, discrimination, and gender-based violence. To you I say, we were born for such a time as this. For they that know their God shall be strong and do great exploits. Let the flames of truth and justice engulf you with divine revelation as you boldly challenge status quo and preach the gospel to this generation, extinguishing the enemy's fiery darts, expanding and cementing your spheres of influence, exemplifying righteous living to exalt the King of glory. Yes, this poem is for today's youth, the revolutionaries of our times, the agents of change and the factors of influence, the dreamers, the hustlers, the doers, and game changers. Tomorrow's mothers and fathers. And as we celebrate the latter, we recognize the same fighting spirit that our fathers had, which courses through our veins and fuels the fire of our cause. This poem is for the fathers who continue to pour of themselves in this generation. This poem is for the youth who will carry the baton further for the next. Happy Father's Day and happy.
up your mouth. Come on, church. Come on, lift up your voice. Lift up your voice.
Of love to your God. Utter words of love to your God. He's here and he wants to hear your heart. If your heart wants to tell him he's holy, tell him that. If your heart wants to tell him you love him, tell him that. If your heart wants to tell him he's worthy, tell him that. If your heart wants to tell him that there's none like him, tell him that. Whatever is in your heart, express it. The lover of your soul is here and he wants to know what the sentiments of your heart are towards him. Come on, open up your mouth towards your Father, towards your God, towards your provider, towards your healer. Come on, speak to your Lord. He's here for you. If only you may just open up your heart and your mouth to him. Tell him your heart. Oh Lord, you're holy. You're full of glory. The earth is full of your splendor. Woo! What a beautiful God you are. What a mighty God you are. What an everlasting Lord you are. We crown you with many crowns, Lord.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to welcome you to Calvary Christian Church, Pretoria East. This is a place that you can call home. We are so glad that you could join us today because this is the day that the Lord has made. We are a church which exalts Christ. We evangelize the lost. We encourage the hurting. We equip the saints and we enrich the community. Our mission is transforming the total man by restoring hope to the hopeless, training leaders, equipping the saints to the building of the church where Christ is Lord. Now today is a very important day because it's Father's Day. Now, to all the fathers out there, we would like to wish you well, and we would like for the Lord to bless you on this wonderful day. We pray and we hope that those around you, your loved ones, your children, make the most of this day with you. And we would also like to say to you that we are grateful and we see the hard work that you put into being good men in our society. We want to thank you for the role that you play in protecting your families. We want to thank you for the role that you play in raising your children. We want to thank you for being involved in your children's life, in your family's life. We want to thank you for even the effort that you put in where it is necessary to grow this community and to make the community a better place to live in. We also want to acknowledge the struggles that you're going through in this current day and age. We pray to the Lord that He gives you the strength to fight for your families and your children where needs be, and to stand up for your families, for your children, for the women in the society when the need arises. We want to thank you yet again for leading us to Christ where you have led us. We want to say that the Lord sees your hard work, and we also see your hard work. Thank you yet again. Happy Father's Day, and may this be a good day for you in Jesus' name. Now I would like to say a little prayer. Can we all pray? Father, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we come before you this evening and we pray in this day and age where things are going the way that they're going. We pray, my Father and my God, for you to heal our land, for you to heal our husbands, heal our brothers, and my Father and my God, put them back into their rightful place where you put them in the garden when you created men. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we also want to pray for the message that we are going to receive in this day. We pray, my Father and my God, that you anoint your servant, that you anoint your servant, O God, that he may speak the oracles of the heavens, that when he speaks into our hearts, he speaks into our lives, that just as you have directed him to. We pray, my Father and my God, for your Holy Spirit, who is not bound by distance, to touch every heart, to touch every heart that is listening to this message that is coming through today. We pray, my Father and my God, that this message is aligned to all the hearts that are listening to this broadcast in this day. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray for your anointing that breaks every yoke, to touch, heal, and deliver all those who are listening to this message and to this broadcast. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray this and we thank you. We thank you because we know that it is done, because we have prayed in faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much, and continue to have a wonderful, wonderful service.
Good morning, Calvarians, and everybody that is joining us this wonderful morning. I am so excited today. It's a special day. We feel special. We feel blessed. We feel empowered today. And thank you so much to Reverend Carol right there for welcoming us and also, you know, celebrating this wonderful day. I mean, out of all the days of the year, yeah, men only have one day after Valentine's, after Mother's Day, after Women's Day. At least this one day, we are so blessed. And we continue to promise that we will continue to build a nation of men that are worthy to take care of our women and making sure that in this season we become relevant. Before we get into the Word of God this morning, I want to just encourage you as well to continue to share and start a watch party with somebody as we get into the word today. I believe it's going to be a powerful service, and make sure that somebody is part of this service this wonderful morning. This coming Tuesday, we as men in the church are also going to be gathering together for our weekly men's cave that we hold, and our focus will be distinctly on praying for the nation and praying for ourselves as well, that God leads us as men, that we are able to be the change that we need to see in this world today, in the time and in the season where gender-based violence has become rife, has become a daily thing. We want to stand against that and pray against that, and we believe that this coming Tuesday, starting from 6:30 in our weekly men's cave, we will be able to stand there. If you want to join us, please drop a WhatsApp on our WhatsApp line and somebody will get a hold of you. We want to remind you yet again that our WhatsApp line is also open. You'll see displaying at the bottom, always open for you to be able to, if you need to talk to somebody, if you need to get somebody to pray with you, if you really need just to also send a testimony through to us or get some information concerning the church, you can drop a number, right, rather drop a text message right there on our WhatsApp, and somebody will be definitely getting back to you in not so long after you have sent us a message. We love you so much and we appreciate you, and we want to also appreciate the young people as well that went through and took their time yet again this week to really be part of this month, which is Youth Month, and also going into a place of also appreciating the fathers as well, and all the way from the United Kingdom as well, in Suku Mumalo. Thank you so much for that wonderful poem that we received as well, in appreciating us as fathers. And I believe that we will definitely continue to do this work mightily and exclusively well in this season and in this time. Let's get right into the Word of God, and we bless God for this season and for this time. The scriptures that we're going to read today, where we started a series about last week already concerning the vessels series, and we continue on that series today, and I really believe that God is going to speak to us mightily. This is a word that God really placed in my spirit and in my heart concerning this time and this season, as the second segment of this powerful and great series that we know is going to change and transform your life. The scriptures we read today, we read two passages of scripture or two books today. I want to start from the book of Acts chapter number 4, and we're going to read verse number 13 to verse number 14. Acts chapter number 4, verse number 13 to verse number 14. If you have found it, I want you to say hashtag I found it right there on the comment section. Acts chapter number 4, verse number 13 to verse number 14. The Bible reads as follows. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished, and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. And we're going to read 1 Corinthians chapter number 1, verse number 25 to verse number 26. Verse number 25 to verse number 29 of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 25 to verse number 29. The scripture reads as follows. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than man. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. So that no human being might boast in the presence of God. We bless the Lord for the reading of His word. This morning I want to share with you under a subject, unworthy vessels. Unworthy vessels. I want you to to nudge your neighbor there and say to them, unworthy vessels. Now the word worthy simply resembles value, or simply speaks of value. Now one of the things I've learned over time is that value is not a generic thing. Okay, value is not something that is of generic notation or generic understanding. Value is personal before it is general. in actual sense, value is something that is held by the person who is dealing with that particular thing. The way you might value R100 when you are a millionaire versus somebody who values R100 when they work, you know, piece jobs and they don't have a permanent job and they don't earn that much money is a different thing. It's a different kind of value. In actual sense, it is what it does for me that gives me the value of it. It is what it means to me that gives me the value of it. Last week when we read scripture in the book of 2 Timothy, we realized that Paul begins to admonish and to speak to Timothy and concerning the vessels that are in a great house. For he says, in a great house, they're not only vessels of silver and gold, but also of clay and wood. And he says, some for honor and some for dishonor. And we established last week that the honor is not in the make of the vessel. It is not in what the vessel is made out of, but the honor is in the work of the vessel. The honor is distinguished by the work that the vessel does. It now therefore becomes important for us to understand that this vessel has been made to do the work by the master. In other words, it is the master that determines what kind of work this vessel must do. It is not the other vessels that determine the value of this vessel. I'm going to get somewhere just now. It is not the other vessels that make this vessel valuable. It is told to us when Paul writes that this work that is done by the master. It is done for the master. It is done to meet the desire of the master. It all depends on what the master wants to achieve. Now, the scripture that we have read in the book of Acts, before I get ahead of myself, is actually quite an important piece of scripture. We understand in the book of Acts chapter number 3, we see Paul Peter and John entering the temple, and when they get to the gate called Beautiful, they find a man who was lame from birth and he had never walked. The Bible says Peter is the one that answered when the man asked for alms, when the man asked to be given money. Peter answers and says, silver and gold we have not, but such as we have we give unto you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Now, that miracle is the one that causes a stir around the whole of Jerusalem. It is the one that causes a problem, because when the vessel was used and it was used to do the good that happened was problematic to a certain section or to a certain faction of the people, namely the Sanhedrin. And we realized in chapter number 4 that we are dealing with the uproar that comes after this miracle. The question is always around the fact, around the fact that how can these guys use the name of Jesus? The issue was in the usage of the name. And they were brought before the council of the Jews. They were brought before the leadership of religion at the time. And when they were brought before these people, the people speaking to them at this point in time said to them, no, listen guys, we don't mind you doing anything else, we don't mind you doing whatever you're doing, but please just get rid of the name. And Peter and John were staunch and they were stern, and they said, no ways can we get rid of the name. We need to hold on to this name, because this is the name that is above every other name. This is the name that we can only use. We cannot use any other name. We cannot even omit the name. We have to speak this name. And we see verse number 13, which is where I really want to get into the gist of where we are. In fact, verse number 11, before we get to verse number 13, Paul says, this Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And I want us to see that Jesus had also gone through rejection. Peter, explains this to us. Says Jesus had also gone through rejection. And when Jesus had also gone through rejection, funny enough, he was rejected by those who were supposed to be leaders of the church. He was rejected by those that were supposed to support him. Have you ever found yourself in a space where the people that are supposed supposed to applaud you are the ones that taunt you. The people that are supposed to lift you up are the ones that pull you down. It is amazing that the rejection did not cause Jesus to leave the work that he is supposed to do. Some of us, we are sitting in a space where we know what we are supposed to do. We know what we are called for. But it appears that the lack of embrace from other people, the lack of embrace from other vessels is always the one that is keeping us down, is always the one that is making us feel like we should not be part of this. And I'm here to say, as much as they might reject you, thank God he did not reject you. As much as they might throw you out, thank God that he is embracing you. As much as they might ignore you, thank God that he is recognizing you. And verse number 13, the Bible says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated common men, they were astonished. This is the trick of where I want to come to. These vessels that God was using, these vessels called Peter and John that God was using, in the standard of everyone else, they did not meet the standard. Why did they not miss the standard? Did they not meet the standard? One of the things that we understand about the growth of, or the growing of Jewish boys, is that when Jewish boys are born, there is a big celebration. One of the reasons why they celebrate, it is because the seed, they have a guarantee that their seed will continue multiplying going on forward. In other words, they would celebrate the birth of a boy so greatly because when a son comes, it means our lineage will continue. But now it would happen that when the son would grow up, he would be definitely taught in the ways of the Jewish, you know, of the Jewish beliefs and understanding as well. But it would come to a point when he was around 10 towards 12 and around the early teens, he would get an opportunity to be part of the elite in the school of Jewish learning. And the way they would want to prove that he is part of the elite would be in such a manner that at around 12 years old, he would be asked to stand before the council of high priests, which was part of the Sanhedrin or part of the council of the Jewish leaders. He would be part of, he would stand before the high priest, when he stands before the high priest, his task would be to memorize, not to even memorize, to recite actually what he's already memorized, which is the Torah, the whole five books. He would be sitting there and he would say it word for word, and he would speak every single word the way it was supposed to be said, and they would look it up to make sure that he's saying it word upon word. This would be a cut-off point. This would be, you know, a gauging point that would say to them that this one we can continue teaching in the school. This one we need to stop teaching. And when you would find yourself in a position where you would fail this particular test, where you would fail to recite the Torah in all its form and in all its books as well, you would find yourself secluded from continuing the studying and the education in the Jewish faith. You'd be excluded from that. And when you'd be excluded from that, what would happen is that once you are excluded, you are excluded to be included in your father's business, in the work that your father does. And this would be the case where you would find people like Peter, people like John, you know, the son of Zebedee, you'd find them coming to a place where they were fishermen. This was their family business. This was a symbol that they tried, but they did not make the cut. They tried, but they did not meet the standard. They tried, but they did not meet the level that was expected. Have you ever been in a place where you try and you don't meet my standard, and you don't meet their standard, and you don't meet what they are expecting you to meet? And sometimes we sit in a place today where whatever we want to talk about, it can be social media, just like the young people were talking about earlier. It can be any level of place where we really want to find ourselves accepted, but we've realized that we did not meet their standard. But interestingly so, Jesus did not go for the educated. Jesus did not go for those that have met a standard. We would have expected Jesus to go, for lack of a better word, shopping for leaders in the Sanhedrin, in the council of the Jews, in those that made it when they had to recite the Torah. But Jesus was not looking for those that have made it. He was looking for those he can make. Sometimes we can find ourselves as vessels that feel like we have made it. Usually when vessels have made it, they are difficult to make. But Jesus was looking for those that he could mold, that he could shape, that he could direct in the right way. And that is why Paul says in the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 4, verse number 7, he says, "For therefore we now have this treasure in earthen vessels." Another version says, "In jars of clay." The question is, why did he choose jars of clay? Why could he not choose vessels of gold, vessels of silver? He did not want them. But the Bible tells us the reason why is so that the glory might not be to man, but might be to God. Sometimes he allows you to be back, to be behind, so that when you come to the front, nobody will receive the glory but himself. I want to speak to a vessel that feels defeated. I want to speak to a vessel that feels like they are destroyed. I want to speak to a vessel that feels like they cannot get anywhere. I want to speak to a vessel. Today you are there. You are listening to the sound of my voice. You feel like it's over with you. You feel like there is no meaning in this life. You feel like there's no direction in this life. I am here to bring a new word to you, that you might be deemed an unworthy vessel, but there is a Father who sees you worthy. There is a Father who sees you good enough. They might have said you are not good enough to meet their standard, but there is a God today who is here to embrace you and use you and work through you and work in you. Even though you might have seemed unworthy to them, he is here to say, "You are mine. You belong to me. You are my vessel. You are the apple of God's eye." Some people have disqualified you, but your disqualification by people was actually your qualification by God. Some people have turned their heads away from you, but their turning their head away from you has been God focusing on you. Some people have passed you like you are nothing, but your passing by them is your noticing by God. And this is today where I really direct a word to those that feel like they're not good enough, to those that feel like they do not make the cut. We have a God who does not work in the standards of man. We have a God who does not work in the levels of men, but the God that works in accordance to the level of his own standard, of his own direction. And this was the problem that the Sanhedrin had. This is the problem that the council of the Jews had. They had a problem that how can they be so bold yet uneducated? How can they be so strong yet uneducated? They thought that education is what gives you anointing. The Bible says many were called, but few were chosen. Amongst those that were chosen were Peter and John, men who were common, men who did not make the cut according to the standard of people. But there is a God who accepts the rejected. There is a God who embraces the dejected. There is a God who says, "Come as you are." There is a God who says, "You don't need to work anything on you. I will work everything on you. And one day when I present you, you will be worthy of my call. You will be worthy of what I am doing." And they said, now when they noticed and saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, this is the interesting thing. Number two, as much as they were uneducated, God did not take away their uneducatedness. God did not remove their uneducation, but he kept it there. There are things that you want so hard for God to remove, but he wants to keep them there. You know why? Because as much as they thought you were unworthy, as much as they thought you were meaningless, as much as they thought you had no purpose in life, God is about to redirect you. God is about to realign you. God is about to place you in the place of your calling. God is about to place you in the track of your calling. They noticed that they were uneducated men. I don't know how they noticed. Maybe it was the way they dressed. Maybe it was the way they did not look expensive. But the looks did not matter. But the looks did not matter. The Bible says that they were common men. They were astonished. There is an astonishment that God wants to do with you as a vessel this coming season. There is an astonishment that God wants to place in the lives of family members that thought you would not become anything. There is an astonishment that he wants to place in the lives of schoolmates that thought you would never amount to anything. You are about to give them a surprise. You are about to appear looking uneducated but doing educated things. Looking like a common man but speaking like an anointed man. There is a shift that God is about to do to another vessel. I want you to take this word and receive it for yourself. Don't wait for anybody to affirm that it's yours. Take it and say it is mine. There is a God that is about to shift you from a place where you were deemed like nothing to a place where you have become something, to a place where you, from a place where you were deemed a nobody to a place where you are to become a somebody. He will not get rid of the evidence, but he will keep the evidence so that they know these are not the works of man. These are not the works of education. These are not the works of the law, but this is the works of grace. But this is the work of God. There are opportunities that people thought will never open up to you. I am an unworthy vessel in your eyes, but to him I am a useful vessel. But to him I am going to be used for the sake of his work. And the Bible says, and they recognize that they had been with Jesus. This is the difference right here. This is the issue right here. As much as you are deemed unworthy of a vessel, as much as you are deemed unworthy of a vessel, the scriptures again in the book of 2 Timothy chapter number 2 where we read last week, the Bible teaches us that this vessel was made for the master's use. And I am here to say, they think I am unworthy, but I have been with Jesus long enough for him to understand that I am useful to him. They recognized they had been with Jesus. The distinct difference here was not education. The distinct difference here was not power. The distinct difference here was not the dressing. The distinct difference was who had they been with. And I want to encourage you today, if you want to move from being an unworthy vessel to being a useful vessel, you better spend time with Jesus. How much time are you spending with him? Can your colleagues recognize that you have been with Jesus? In fact, let it not be you have been, let it be you are with Jesus. It was the difference that came upon Peter and John's life. They were not rich, but they had Jesus. They did not have money to give the blind man, the lame man, but they had Jesus. They did not have a high position in the community, but they had Jesus. The difference in this season in your business will be you have Jesus. The difference in this season in your church will be you have Jesus. The difference in this season in your marriage will be when you have Jesus. They thought you would never make it, but they recognized you have been with Jesus. They thought you would never come to anything, but they recognized you have been with Jesus. I am here to encourage somebody, spend time with Jesus. Jesus will be the flavor of your life. Jesus will be the difference of your life. This is how unworthy vessels become worthy. This is how despised vessels become important in the house. I don't care what they say. My issue is, who are you with? It is Jesus that will turn your life around. It is Jesus that will transform your life around. It was not only that they had been with Jesus. Verse number 14 says to us, but seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. Okay, this is where I want to come to. He's not just going to make you a worthy vessel. No. He's not just going to make you a useful vessel, but there's going to be evidence that's undeniable. There's going to be evidence that cannot be denied. Get ready for God to put some evidence that cannot be denied before you. Even if they wanted to deny them any level of upliftment, any level of, of appreciation, any level of recognition, there was an evidence that was standing. And I'm saying, whatever was lame in your life is going to be an evidence that God is with you. Whatever was lame in your life is going to be evidence as it stands next to you. They will not be able to deny this is a vessel used by God. This is a vessel used by him. And I don't know which pastor I'm talking to, but there is a pastor who wants to give up on ministry. There is a pastor who wants to throw in the towel. I know during lockdown you did not know how to pay the rent. You did not know what is going to happen. But I'm here to say, man of God, woman of God, don't throw in the towel. There's going to gonna be a lame man, a previously lame man that's gonna be standing next to you, and they're not gonna deny that God is your God, that Jehovah Jireh is providing for you, that Jehovah has called you. You are called of God. Don't throw in the towel. There's gonna be an evidence. This is so strong in my spirit. There's gonna be an evidence that no one can deny. There's gonna be a shift that no one can deny. There's gonna be a change that no one can deny. Prepare yourself. Prepare your household. Prepare your household. There's about to be a lame thing that's gonna be standing. There's about to be a lame thing that's gonna be walking. There's about to be undeniable, sexual, tangible evidence that God is using you, that God has called you for such a season and a time as this. I know they have rejected your ministry. I know they have turned away from you. I know they have said you can't make it. I know they have said you cannot become part of them. I know they have created this group of leaders or this group of people that says you are not fit to be there. But I'm here to change you. I am here to tell you right now that God has called you. The call of God upon your life is strong. The call of God upon your life is evident. There will be undeniable evidence. There will be undeniable evidence that God has called you. I don't know whose word this is, but receive it right now. Receive it right now. He has called you. He has called you. He has called you. You did not fall there by mistake. You did not fall there by chance. They thought you were unworthy vessel, but he has called you into that business. He has called you into that marriage. He has called you into that family. He has called you into that position. He has called you. Don't give up right now. You are just a vessel that is to be used by him. The standard that they have gauged you on is not the standard that he has put you on. He has put you at a higher dimension, at a higher level, at his standard. Receive this word right now, for you are a worthy vessel, deemed to be used by him, deemed by him to be used. And let us go. As we come to the tail end of this message, I want you to understand that in the book of Corinthians, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter number 1, verse number 25, for the foolishness of God is wiser than men. The weakness of God is stronger than men. Now, the issue is, whose foolishness are we talking about? Whose weakness are we talking about? This is not just anybody's weakness. This is not just anybody's foolishness. But this one belongs to God. Have you ever seen that the foolishness of God is wiser than men? Have you ever seen that the weakness of God is stronger than men? In other words, what other people see as a weak choice, God sees as the strong choice. What other people see as the foolish choice, God sees as the wise choice. You are a secret weapon in what he is doing. You are a secret weapon in what he has called you to do. When Jesus was born, it seemed like just a joke. It seemed like, how can a young man, how can a young boy come and change the world? But what they did not know is that his foolishness, yes, his foolishness is wiser than their wisdom. His weakness is wiser than their strength. And the Bible says that, for consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were noble of birth. Now understand this. He was actually saying, when you were called, you did not fit the call according to the standards of the world. According to the standards of the world, you were not wise. You know, when people looked at you, they never saw wisdom. But the one who chose you, the one who chose you knew what he was going to do with you. The one who chose you understood what he's going to do with you. And this morning, I want you to understand that you were not chosen by man. Stop trying to meet their standards. They are not your master. They are not the owners of the house. They are not the ones who have called you. Many of us have lowered our standard. Many of us have lowered our level because we want to fit in. We want to be in the mix. We want to be, you know, there and be accepted. Don't be accepted by man yet rejected by God. Don't fit the standards of man yet miss the standard of God. It is God whom the Bible says that he did not choose you according to worldly standards, but he chose you despite the fact that you were not wise, you were not powerful, you were not You are not of a noble birth. The reason why he did this, he reiterates what he says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. He says that, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. He did these things just to make sure that those that thought they have made it, those that thought they were ahead of you, they will be shamed in seeing you who was following. Now they will be following. They will be ashamed when they thought they were strong. They will be ashamed in seeing that you are stronger than them. There's about to be a miracle. Somebody is about to ask, how did this happen? How did you get here? It was not you, baby, that chose me. It was not you that called me. You to understand that today he is choosing what we deem unworthy. Aha, he's about to even surprise me, because what I think is worthy, according to him, is not worthy. What he thinks, what I think is unworthy, according to him, is worthy. He says he chooses the weak things of this world to despise the strong and to deal with the strong. He chooses the foolish things of this world to deal with the wise. But now again he says God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. Now there are things that are not. Okay, this is beautiful for me. There are things that are not. There are things that do not seem like they are there. There are things that there are things that look invisible. They look not there, but he has chosen them. He has chosen somebody who can stutter like Moses. He says, I want you, the first job I want you to see, I want you to go and do, is to speak to Pharaoh. When I stutter, the place of my weakness is the place he wants to use. He came and he chose again somebody like Jacob, who was, a thief of note, a deceiver of note. And he says, I want to make a nation out of you. Notice that God's pattern is a pattern of choosing those that are deemed unworthy by the world. Those that are deemed unworthy by the world. And he says, this is the reason why, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. This is the trick. The problem is, if he chooses the strong, they will think we qualified because we are strong. If he chooses the wise, they will think they qualified because they are wise or they are educated. If he chooses the rich, they will think they qualified because they have the money. But he's about to take somebody you never thought of. He's about to take somebody you despised. He's about to choose somebody you despised. When he wanted to save the nation of Israel in the Canaanites or in Canaan, he used a harlot called Rahab. You know why? Because whatever she could do, whatever we deemed was a weakness, which was her ability to control men and to hide men as a harlot, God used it for his glory. God used it to save a nation. And I want you to understand that which you thought was despised by us is what God appreciates right now. You might think you are an unworthy vessel, but I'm here to say he's about to change your story. 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 Because worthiness is all about what you're going to do for me. Worthiness is about a personal value that I see. God has seen a value that your mother might not have seen. God has seen a value that your husband might not have seen. God has seen a value that your wife might not have seen. God has seen a value, yes, I'm going to say this, that the church might not have seen. God has seen a value that even I as your pastor might not have seen, because he's a God who sees things from a different perspective. He's a God who sees things from a different direction. He's a God who sees things from a different place. He's a God who sees things from a different place altogether. And today he is seeing me differently. And today he understands me differently. And today he sees that which people despised, but being worthy before his eyes. And this is what scripture says. Scripture tells us that it is God's choosing. God's category of choosing is not our category of choosing. God's way of choosing is not our way of choosing. God's direction of choosing is not our direction of choosing. Who would have thought that a young man like myself, deeply addicted to pornography for 3.5 years, would be used by God? I never thought I'd be worthy. Who would have thought that a terrorizer of the church soul would be used by God? Who would have thought Peter, who denied Christ 3 times, would be the same one who would bring 3,000 souls in a sermon that he preached. Who would have thought that a deceiver would be Israel today? Who would have thought that Ruth, who was a product of incest, would be a mother to a grandmother to David, who was the lineage of Christ himself? Who would have thought? And I'm here to say he's about to do what they would never have thought. He's about to shift you in a direction they never have thought. They would be astonished because they never planned for you. In actual sense, they never saved a seat for you in the ground. They never saved a seat for you in the table. But where there was no seat, God is about to create some space. God is about to shift you to that place. God is about to take you to that place. Because the importance or the value is not the standard of man, but the value is the standard of God. Let's finish off. I've brought back that lovely cup that we had last week, which is my little daughter's cup. And I brought it back for a purpose, for us to understand that if I was in a thirsty desert, in a thirsty place, and I needed water, it does not matter what the water came in. It matters that the water is there, okay? It does not matter what the water came in. The vessel might look useless. The vessel might look inexpensive. It does not matter what the water came in, but it matters that the water is there. And some people are saying, how can God use you? It does not matter what he is using. It matters that you are useful. It does not matter how you look up. It matters that you are useful. To him, he's only concerned about the fact that he can use you. Allow yourself, avail yourself, get rid of the stigma that has been attached onto you, get rid of the connotation that has been attached on you, get rid of the lack of expectation that people have over your life, and come to the place where you say, here I am, use me. Here I am, use me. And this is my desire this morning, that as we come to this close of this service, you realize and you remember that God has called you, even though they thought you were unworthy, even though they thought you were meaningless, even though they thought you would amount to nothing. At least it is not them that is choosing. The Bible says God chose, but God chose. It is God that chose. In the book of 1 Corinthians, the Bible says, chapter number 1, the Bible says God chose. It is God who chose. Thank God it is not my friends that are choosing. Thank God it is not my company that is choosing. Thank God it is not my my husband or my wife that is choosing, but God chose. But God chose. I don't know where we made you feel unworthy. I don't know where we made you feel unimportant. I don't know where we made you feel, you know, redundant. But God chose. But God chose. But God chose. And this wonderful morning, I want you to believe that you were chosen, not by mistake, not by chance, but by purpose. But by purpose, he chose. And this morning, I want to pray for some people, or pray with some people that feel like they are not meaningful in this life. They want to throw in their towel. They want to get away from this life. Some of you are in the border of hanging yourself. Some of you are in the border of taking your own life because you feel that life is meaningless. I'm here to present a God who is waiting to use you, who has chosen you by choice, who has chosen you not by chance, but I'm here to present a God who has chosen you because of purpose. He wants to use you. He wants to work with you. He wants to work in you. He wants to work through you. And this morning, you might be there. You might be hearing my voice. I'm here to say, presenting another chance to you, presenting another opportunity to you, that the season that God has meant for you is finally here. Don't throw in the towel. Don't walk out of that marriage. Don't walk out of that life. Don't walk out of that place. Don't kill yourself. Don't take your life. Don't take it. No, 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 no. Don't take it. Men of God, women of God, don't give up. Hold on. Hold on. He's about to do something that will make sure people understand that you did not call yourself. You were called by God. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray this wonderful morning, there's a heart that wants to give up. There's a heart that wants to throw in the towel. There's a heart that is ready to walk out of that love and that relationship. There's a heart that is ready to walk out of that journey. But Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, the Lord God Almighty, may they be evidence that is undeniable. May they be evidence that is unquestionable. May they be evidence that is unquestionable that says God has really and truly called you. And Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that vessel that feels unworthy, that vessel that feels like they cannot make it in this life, I decree a rejuvenation of life. I decree a rejuvenation of hope. I decree a rejuvenation of direction, oh Father. In the name of Jesus, mighty God, I pray that even in this time, that even in this season, Lord, it shall be known that you are the God who has called us. You are the God who has chosen us. In the mighty, precious, and wonderful name of Jesus, I pray that Ancient of Days, that wonderful Savior, that great and wonderful God, it is your presence and it is your mercy that will minister into our hearts and into our lives. And Lord, I pray this morning that, Father, somebody will testify that my life has been rejuvenated. My life has been renewed. I've been redirected. I now understand why he has called me. I now understand why he has called me. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that heart, that life that wants to give up, mighty God, will be your God, Father, given a new zeal in life, will be given a new direction in life. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that God Almighty, it shall be so, and it shall be done in this season. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. And as much as we're praying right now, if you have not given your life to Christ, this is an opportunity for you to be able to meet him today, to be able to give your life to him. And I want you to follow me in this prayer. If you feel convicted to receive him today as your Lord and personal Savior, follow me in this prayer this morning. I want you to say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you and I surrender my life to you. I speak today that my life belongs to you. And today, I am a new creation. I believe that Christ died for me, and he is the Savior of the world, the Savior of my life. And I am today a new creation and a child of God. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen and amen. I believe that God has come into your heart, and he has done a work that no man can do. He has made you a vessel that is worthy to be used by him. And if you feel you need somebody to talk to today, if you need somebody to be able to pray with you today, if you need somebody to be able to help you and talk to you, you'll see our WhatsApp line display right there. Drop a text right there, and somebody will make sure that somebody gets a hold of you, speaks with you, and prays for you, counsels you, and leads you even in this season and in this time, that the Lord might be able to do what he desires through your life and in your life. And as we wrap up this morning, we encourage you to partner with us. Be a partner for us and make sure that we continue to do this work so that it can be impactful into the world. We encourage you to give an offering, to give a tithe, to give whatever you want to give directly into this work, that you see our banking details appear right there. Make sure that you become part of this. And as you become part of this, may God richly do what no man can do in your life. May God bless you richly and greatly, that we are able to see the work of God and the power of God within your life as he shows up and he shows himself strong. May God bless you. We love you and we appreciate you so much. And we pray that you have a powerful week and a great and a blessed week as well. We love you and we shall meet next week, same time, same place. God bless you.
Blessings. Blessings to you, family. And thank you for joining us in today's service. We pray to the Lord that you were blessed by his word today. And remember to stay in touch, stay informed, and stay connected on our social media platforms. Follow us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp. And remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. So it's farewell for now. From Calvary Christian Church, a church you can call home.